Welcome everybody, wherever you are on the planet. My name is René Moldejonge and I'm the open source lead for Microsoft Western Europe. And today we're going to talk about Microsoft and open source. We have an appealing program for you. We have customers and partners discussing discussing their solutions on open source. And before we get to that section, I'm going to talk about Microsoft and open source in general. Open source is changing software development. Over 40% of CIOs have open source as their primary software strategy. And 96% of deployed applications are using open source software. Between 80 and 90% of the code in new applications comes from open source. That means that 20% of the 100%, they can focus on creating their competitive advantage. How appealing is that? So they're using between 70 and 80% of the open source components, so they can focus on creating that competitive advantage while focusing on the between the 10 and 20%. It's also the open source is the biggest differentiator for organizations. Based on the McKinsey research, open source adoption is the biggest differentiator for top performing organizations. These organizations are seeing 3 times more impact from the adoption of open source than the rest of the industry. Organizations who are best in class on open source capabilities also score 30% higher on innovation and 20% higher on developer satisfaction. And we all know developers, we need to be sure that we please developers because they create the differentiating they create differentiating technology for you. We're quite pleased to have somebody like Satya. Tech companies born with an open source mentality get it. It's our ability to work together that makes our dreams believable and ultimately achievable. We must learn to build on the ideas of others. Satya really saw this potential early on when we started this journey. He didn't want to become some legacy software company that just lets customers use his own product in the cloud, but he wanted to make Azure a platform for whatever our customers want to do and for us to support them in the best way. So offer choice. Offer choice to our customers no matter what kind of type of technology they want to use. Another famous statement is just as by the action we've taken in the recent past, our action today and in the future. And this symbolizes also the approach, our approach. We don't only want to talk the talk, we also want to walk the walk. And let me offer you some proof points. Open source is at the core of Microsoft. We have approximately 30,000 employees utilizing open source technology, and about 60,000 of unique open source components. The compelling part is the number of components in use within Microsoft, 9.5 million. And this growth has been significantly and exponentially. We don't want to know what's going to happen in a couple of years. This is going to rise tremendously. And it's not only us, it's not only all the different communities, it's also you as a customer, you as a partner. All of our top 100 Microsoft customers are using Linux, open source databases, Kubernetes, or any other open source technology. If we talk about Microsoft contribution to open source, we defined 5 different aspects: Linux, cloud native, languages, data and AI, and web. Within the Linux domain, I think we have over a decade of collaboration going on. If we talk about cloud native, we don't only talk about the container runtime, but also orchestration. Talk about technologies like communities like Dapper, Helm, CNAPP, and many more. Languages, not only the Microsoft technologies like .NET or C#, but also Java technologies, Python, Rust, Golang, just to name a few. In the data and artificial intelligence, we've also come a long way, not only supporting the Microsoft side, but also the Spark, talking about Postgres, talking about Onyx, and many more examples within that domain. And last but not least, the web. If I talk about strategy themes, because if we are utilizing open source, if we are contributing to open source communities, we need to have some structure in place. That's talking about working with others, innovation with intention, supply chain security, and communicating openly. On the working with others, I have prepared some slides to talk a little bit more about it. If we talk about innovation with intention, we talk about processes from a legal point of view. We've created an open source program office just to ensure that we have regulations in place, what our internal employees need to do if they want to contribute code and do it the right way. Security is an important part of it, obviously. So we've also joined a security foundation just to ensure that security is an important part of what we do and we do it safely. And communicating openly, it's about accountability, it's about mindshare, it's about sharing on all kinds of different platforms what we're doing. Working with others. There's the first element of working with others is our support, to different foundations. Working with others has a commercial side and has a community side. Microsoft is proud to participate, partner and sponsor many amazing initiatives to better the open source ecosystem. The Linux Foundation is a good example where we have John Gossman, he's part of it. We've got the Cloud Native Computing Foundation. We're really proud that we have Brandon Burns as part of Microsoft. That's also part of that foundation. There are many more people that are part of the foundation. And the Open Container Initiative, which is also a really nice example where we definitely want to contribute in ensuring that we do what's best for all the communities out there. The other part is collaborating, working together with the Azure open source ecosystem. You can see all kinds of logos there in here. Red Hat, SUSE, there's Cloudera, there's HashiCorp, there's Redis, and many, many, many other logos that are in there. And we've moved away from stronger together, better together to jointly engineering, jointly operate, and also offer joint support. And in the next video, we have asked and we've collaborated together with Red Hat to explain to you what we're doing together.
Traditionally, Microsoft and Red Hat competed in the operating system space. But a few years ago, we started realizing that customers were using both Red Hat and Windows, Java and .NET, and almost every customer was asking us to work together.
Microsoft is one of our most important strategic partners, both because of the Azure business as well as the on-premise business that they do.
It's great that we're both focused on the customer and we work closely on developing the solutions as well as supporting the solution. Having a really great customer experience is really critical for both of us. Our engineers are sitting together so customers can go call one number and get their issues resolved without worrying about is it a Red Hat issue or is it a Microsoft issue?
And you have the two most widely deployed operating systems in the industry. Customers can now co-mingle those applications and workloads together on Azure, and they get two enterprise companies standing behind that with dedicated on-site technical support.
One example would be Lufthansa. Lufthansa uses the entire OpenShift RHEL stack running on Azure together, and they've been able to see like 50% cost reductions because of that. Another great example would be Deutsche Bank, which moved to the combined Azure Red Hat OpenShift service, and they were able to get their proof of concept production times down to about 3 weeks. So when Microsoft and Red Hat started working together, it was a small number of things. Red Hat Enterprise Linux for Hyper-V, RHEL for Azure, and then over time we've added OpenShift support working together on JBoss, on Ansible, and SQL Server for RHEL.
We see customers having heterogeneous platforms, whether that's Linux, Windows Server, the cloud, data center, the emerging edge. We are committed to delivering solutions to meet customers where they are. And so that could be virtual machines, containers, or even platform as a service services.
When Microsoft and Red Hat work together on these solutions for customers, they get better integrations, they get better support, and it's much more likely that jointly, we'll just be able to solve their problem end to end.
I really, really love this video. And this partnership is not just on paper. There's Paul Cormier and Satya Nadella collaborating. We had Satya on stage a couple of years ago in Boston, where he answered to a question, you know, why are you working so much together? It's what our customers expect from us. there are no boundaries anymore. Whether it's closed source or open source, we're here to support you no matter where you are. Open source in action. In the introduction, I already explained to you, we have some great stories, we have got some great customers, and we have some great partners that will share their experiences. But let's move to that section. And before we're going to move there, I'm going to talk about Linux on Azure, OSS Modern App Development, and the database part. And it's not necessarily that I want to emphasize those different components. It's about the customer journey. We want to understand from you, where are you in this customer journey? What's your cloud strategy? What are your cloud initiatives which you're setting up? What's your container strategy? Have you done a full application assessment already? And last but not least, what's your innovation agenda? So if I encourage everybody also internal at Microsoft and also all our reps to have those type of conversations with the customers so we can jointly support you so you can create your digital transformation agenda. And based on that, it could be the case that you want to migrate certain workloads to a cloud. And we want to make sure that you think that and you also feel that Microsoft is the best cloud out there to support all your workloads. So we want to capture the total migratable estate and remove the boundaries, whether it's open source, whether it's based on Linux, whether it's based on Windows, whether it's based on open source database technology or SQL. We want to capture the total migratable estate so we can support you in moving those workloads to Azure. So that's that part. The other part is, once you've done an application assessment and you want to move also some applications, you want to rehost, refactor, or whatever you want to do with them, you've created your roadmap for it, we're also there to support you. And we want to offer you choice, what type of technology you want to use for that. And last but not least, it's also the database part. It's there's all kinds of artificial intelligence, machine learning technology in there that we can also support. Azure, best cloud for Linux. So this, I do want to offer some proof points and some facts. Because did you know that over 50% of the VM cores are Linux-based? And 60% of Azure Marketplace images are also Linux-based. And if we would review our own internal usage, own cloud usage, over a third is running already on Linux. And we've doubled that last year. So imagine what's going to happen next year. And I mentioned before, the top 100 Microsoft customers deploy Linux workloads on Azure. We're working together with all kinds of Linux vendors. Red Hat already mentioned, Canonical, SUSE, and there are many more that we also support. We have multiple versions of Linux that we support on Azure. Open source databases. We can talk hours about this subject, but we only have limited time, so I just want to trigger you. If you want to learn more, there's so much information to find about this, and there are so many sessions also on Ignite that can teach you what we're doing on that side. Whether it's MariaDB, whether it's Postgres, whether it's Redis, the work we're doing together with Databricks, for instance, there's so many to discuss, so many to present, so many things to present. Please look up for a couple of those sessions and find a couple of those sessions and consume them. And if you have questions, let us know. Flexibility. So now I'm going to move to the app side, flexibility of choice for modern app development. And as this slide tells you, Kubernetes on Azure, and there are containers. And in order to orchestrate multiple containers, you need to have an orchestration mechanism, which Kubernetes is. And there are, I think, tens of different Kubernetes versions out there. We've got Azure Kubernetes Service, there's Azure Red Hat OpenShift, there's Rancher, and there are multiple different solutions out there. And we offer choice. And that's the key thing I want to emphasize. We offer choice for you as a customer. So what type of technology you want to use, we want to make sure that we support it. Not only on the platform side of the Kubernetes flavor, also when it comes to development tools or within the different communities. This is a set of, because if we talk about developers, they want to work with tools that they like, whether it's Jenkins, whether it's Puppets, whether it's Jira, GitHub, Nagios. We offer that support, and we want to ensure that we extend that support, and if there's new technology that's popping up, we want to be there. Now let's move to the exciting part. Maarten Goed from Wortel, he created a really, really nice video together with his team. He served his customer, Wortel, together with us to create amazing things. Let's watch the video. Over to you, Maarten.
Thank you, René. Let me show you what Wortel has done for KPMG, building a worldwide scalable platform using Microsoft Azure and open source.
This project is about KPMG Ignition, facilitating cloud services worldwide for KPMG member firms and customers. Think about Japan, Australia, New Zealand, the Nordics, basically everywhere. They use Microsoft Azure as their primary cloud provider and open source tools and services. Think about Git, Azure DevOps, Kubernetes, PowerShell to make this all work.
The project is bleeding edge and we are pushing the boundaries with Microsoft technologies. In Cloud Next, we are building a data and analytics platform for KPMG and their partners to run safe and secure and scalable data analytics workloads.
We've chosen cloud native. That means no direct VMs. We use containers as our flexible compute option, and those containers are orchestrated to Azure Kubernetes services.
We're using Azure combined with open source, using technologies like Data Lake, Synapse, and Databricks.
To support our platform everywhere, we've built our hybrid solution based on Azure Arc. This enables KPMG to extend the manageability of Kubernetes and data services to any data center.
In Azure Databricks, we are enabling open source components to support our analytic workflows.
Our team is using Visual Studio Code with open source extensions. This helps with a consistent way of working.
In Azure Synapse, we can achieve ridiculous scale by scaling compute resources separate from the storage resources.
Our build framework is based on PowerShell, using open source modules like Pester for unit and integration testing, Script Analyzer, Platypus, and Invoke Build, and others.
Data scientists with Python skills can easily be onboarded on Databricks in our Azure platform.
The partnership with Microsoft engineering teams has been amazing. For me, the Azure innovation train just never stops, with technologies like Azure Kubernetes Services, Azure Functions, Azure DevOps and GitHub, and others.
For every data and analytics problem, there is a solution in Azure. The direct contact with Microsoft support has been great. The cool thing is, we've only just begun.
It has been a fantastic journey together with KPMG building a worldwide scalable Azure platform with open source technologies. Wortel is the go-to partner for building cloud-native Azure solutions and for advanced analytics. The Octocat approves. Back to you, René.
That was a compelling, compelling story. Thanks a lot, Maarten, and really, really thankful for all the hard work you put into this. Not only servicing the customer, but also documenting what you've done in creating this video. Thanks a lot on behalf of us. Let's move to the next story. Elkjøp. Elkjøp is a company based out of Norway. They're a retailer. And if you want to know the magnitude, they've got warehouses bigger than IKEA. Gustav Kaleta is part of the Global Black Belt organization, and he actually recorded a nice interview with Henry Hagnas from Elkjøp. Over to you, Gustav.
Hi. So my name is Gustav. I'm a part of the Global Black Belt team as a tech specialist focusing on microservices architecture in Kubernetes on Azure. Today I have Henry with me from Elkjøp. And Henry, can you please introduce yourself?
Hello, everyone. I'm Henry Hagnes. I am a cloud architect at Elkjøp Nordic. We are the biggest electronics retailer in the Nordics. We have 10,000 employees, over 400 stores. And the last few years, we've been focusing a lot on IT infrastructure modernization. We've implemented lots of APIs. We've moved SAP to Azure. And we've also implemented a whole new point of sale system. So I'm really proud to be here to speak with you guys so that I can tell you more about it.
We're super excited. So could you walk us through all the Kubernetes journey and how that basically started?
So it started about 2 years ago when I got the responsibility to around infrastructure for our microservices architecture. I saw that that the current approach would not scale for our future demands. So I was in the process of evaluating different options on how to improve this when I saw you talk at a conference about Kubernetes.
Yeah, I remember that you coming up and giving me a challenge of we can move several hundreds of microservices onto Kubernetes. Could you tell us a little bit about how all of this basically started?
When I started with this, we already had a pretty solid microservices architecture. It was built on Azure Web Apps using Cosmos DB, Azure API Management, Service Bus, all the, these good stable components from the Azure environment. Web apps are really good. They are a great start, but when you start having a lot of them, you have issues with operations and scaling. And we also knew that the APIs will be more central in the future enterprise architecture, so we needed to improve.
So could you tell us a little bit about why you chose to look at Kubernetes in this case, and what's the benefit of running workloads like that?
So, like I mentioned, the operational improvements are really important. Handling hundreds of Azure web apps is hard, and it's hard to identify errors. Kubernetes, in turn, is really flexible. It allows us to pick and choose the open source components that we want, and that means that we can make it our own serious enterprise platform and a really solid replacement for Azure web apps.
Could you walk us through some of the core open source components in your architecture?
Yeah, so like you see here on the picture, we haven't changed much around the Kubernetes environment. Instead, we've replaced and improved on what Azure Web Apps provide us. So we have the traffic ingress controller for inbound traffic. We have the Linkerd service mesh, and then we have Prometheus and Grafana collecting and displaying metrics.
I know that Linkerd is obviously a core component in your setup. Could you walk us through what that basically give you of insights?
So one of the key benefits of a service mesh is the network level security that you get, but it's also a but from our point of view, the most important was the network level insights that it gives us. Using Linkerd, we can make debugging much faster, and it makes it so that the discussion between platform team and the developers focuses on facts instead of a blame game between them around whose fault this is.
So what kind of challenges did you basically encounter?
So the fun part with moving to Kubernetes and gaining a lot of observability into our environment was that we in fact found many bugs and future performance problems that we could catch with these improved tools that we were using. But the worst issue that we had was this network issue that you too helped us troubleshoot just before the launch in Denmark, in fact. It turned out so that some of our network code was inefficient and hit a limit of source network address translation ports. And anyone watching, check this out, because that's really mysterious unless you know what you're doing.
Exactly. I remember that. That was an intense day just before launch. So could you walk us through the Black Friday scenarios and how you prepared yourself for that?
So this year, we extended Black Friday to over a week for the protection of our customers and our employees. And having an important event span so long time puts a lot of pressure on the operations team. But we, in fact, didn't have any problems at all, so we were mostly bored.
Boring's always good in IT, so what's the current plan? What's the current status today, and what kind of plans do you have for the future?
Just recently, we moved the last of the microservices that are now 200 into the Kubernetes environment. The new point of sale system is running really smoothly, and we're rolling it out into all countries as we speak. So that means that by the end of the year, all our $5 billion worth of sales is going through these new Kubernetes systems. But we do sleep well. We have really good control over our systems, and we have good support from you guys. So thank you, Gustav.
No worries. So if you want to read more about this case story that we did with Elship running on AKS on Azure with super cool open source technologies, you can read about it down here in the link below. Henry, thank you so much for joining this call and talking about your experiences with open source technologies on Azure. And thank you for listening today. Have a good day. Bye.
Fantastic work, guys. Thanks a lot, Henry, for taking the time to talk to Gustav and share your experiences. And that's what it's all about, building together in open source. And that's what we tried to show to you during this session. Open, collaborative, flexible. And as you can see, we've added some photos to this slide. All the presenters, all the stakeholders the presenters that created this video are in this are in this picture. Multiple people are contributing to open source, also from the Microsoft domain, talking about 30,000 people. And if you add up the extended ecosystem, it's even more. I want to leave you with the following. Become part of the Open Source Acceleration Program. There are multiple partners that are support us in this journey. Make sure to connect to your local partner, because those are the ones also that can support you in creating baby steps. No matter where you are in your customer journey, we're there to support you. If you want to migrate workloads, if you want to move some applications, if you want to modernize some applications, we're here to support you. And we've got acceleration programs to guide you throughout that process. Contact your local representatives. And in case of questions, please reach out to me. I'm also here to help you and make sure that you get directed to the right person to take the first step in this journey. And last but not least, developers are key to all of us. So we want to make sure that we also service their needs in creating compelling hackathons. We created something called the Azure Adventure Days, which has increasingly complex challenges that will trigger their minds, that will trigger your mind to solve them. And last but not least, upscale yourself to the Enterprise Skills Initiative. During this session, I tried to give you some proof points. Microsoft and open source, we're not only talking the talk, we're also walking the walk, and that's going to be extended in the next couple of years even more. Expect more from us. And no matter where you are in your customer journey, in your journey to get into a more innovative state, we're here to support you. So on behalf of Microsoft and the whole open source organization, thank you very much. And I want to wish you the best day ever.